very glad to be here and to have this opportunity to talk to you about our Schrödinger cat experiments in Paris. So I like to symbolize this experiment with this picture, which was made by my colleague Michel Bruyn, which shows a juggler juggling with balls bouncing between two mirrors. In fact, these balls are photons, and our game is to try to keep them bouncing for as long as possible, observing them without destroying the photons and trying from there to react back on the field to prepare the field in some non-classical states, including Schrödinger cat state, and study how they evolve. So we think that we are, in this way, realizing some of the thought experiments of the early days of quantum physics. And as you know, of course, by doing that, we also experiment steps of which could be useful for quantum information procedures. I like to come back to the early days of quantum physics when I describe these experiments, because as you will know, the ingredients that we are using, the photons, the cavities, the atoms that we are using, were in fact described in these early days of quantum physics. You know that the story started with a 1905 paper by Einstein, who said, discovered that light waves are quantized in terms of photons, whose energy are related to the frequency through Planck's constant. And some 8 years later, Bohr introduced the quantization principle for matter for the first time by quantizing the electronic orbits in atoms, again introducing Planck's constant for that. And I like to come back to this because we are celebrating this year the 100th year anniversary of the Bohr model. And in fact, this Bohr atom, this planetary atom, is a Rydberg atom, and this is the kind of atom we are using in our experiments. 10 years later, De Broglie used this wave matter dualism to say that matter was also made of waves, and this explains the Bohr quantization very well. If you assume that the electron running wave going around the orbit makes an integral number of De Broglie wavelengths, you find the Bohr quantization rule. So, in fact, these pre-modern quantum area were very important results because, as Einstein said, they allowed us and allowed these scientists to lift progressively the great veil which was concealing the macroscopic world to us. And this lifting, of course, culminated with the quantum theory in 1926, which introduced this wave-particle dualism into the description of the world at the microscopic level. And this is, of course, the basis of the superposition principle, which challenges all the classical ideas that we have about determinism and physical reality and opened the way to all the studies which have been done since. I would like to remind us of some of the thought experiments which were developed at that time. At that time, it was impossible to work with single particles, and in order to make sense of this new physics, Einstein and Bohr discussed, especially at the Solvay meeting, these ideas. And you see here on the left the Young double slit experiment as it was designed by Einstein. In fact, Einstein did not like this idea that this dualism, and he tried to imagine an experiment in which you would be able to find the path of the particle through the apparatus and at the same time see the fringes. His idea was that the upper slit, for instance, could be a very light system, and we should just try to detect the momentum transfer to the movable slit. If the particle goes through the upper slit, it will kick this slit, which will recoil, and this will be a sign that the particle has gone through the upper slit. And of course, Bohr answered that this requires to define the slit initial momentum with a very small delta p, if you want to see momentum change. So delta x is large, according to Heisenberg uncertainty relation. And if delta x is large, the fringes are blurred because of the uncertainty in the path difference. So at least quantum mechanics is consistent. What I want to say is that this argument did not use the principle, the notion of entanglement. But of course, the concept of entanglement is already here. When the particle crosses the apparatus, it crosses it in a superposition of being through the upper slit and through the lower slit at once. Now, if the upper slit can move, then you have an entanglement because the particle crossing through the upper slit is correlated to the upper slit motion, and if the particle crosses the lower slit, the upper slit does not move. And so now we have an entanglement between the particle and the slit, and this is, of course, as we know from modern quantum physics, this is this entanglement which kills the coherence, because if you trace over the motion of the upper slit, you don't have a wave function anymore for the particle. So I insisted on that because if you think about it, this is already a Schrodinger cat. You have a coupling of a particle with a big system, which is the slit, and the slit is not dead or alive, but the slit is in motion or not in motion, and it is exactly the same idea. And also, of course, all the principle of decoherence are behind that, because if you think of the slit as an environment, you see that you get information into the slit motion and you lose the coherence. I want also to mention another thought experiment, which was this time presented by Einstein at the next Solvay meeting in 1930, and he was challenging the time, energy, and certainty relation with the famous photon box experiment. The idea of Einstein was the following. You just trap a photon in a box. The box has inner walls, very highly reflecting walls, so the photons can be kept for as long as you want. And then you have a shutter which can be opened and closed for a very short time, and which is triggered by a clock, which is able to measure the time with precision. And so if you weigh the box in the gravitational field through the E equal mc squared relationship, you will know how many photons you have in the box. And then you open the box for a very short time, you weigh the box after that, you have a delta E as small as you want and delta T as small as you want. It took some, Bohr is supposed to have been very annoyed by this argument and spent a sleepless night, and then he came with a kind of lawyer, what I think it's a crook lawyer argument he came back with. He said that in fact you have to be careful because you have to use the general theory of relativity. If the box is going up and down, the time that this clock will measure will depend upon its height in the gravitational field, and our friend Dave Wynum knows that because he did exactly this experiment some 80 years later. And the uncertainty that you get from that is exactly what you need to show that this Heisenberg uncertainty relation is satisfied. I am not satisfied with this argument because I don't like the idea that you need general relativity to find that quantum mechanics is consistent, because 100 years later we still don't have a complete theory of quantum physics and relativity, but this is not the issue here. What I want to stress is that we have a photon box which involves a clock to time the escape of light quanta, and this is exactly the kind of experiment that we are doing now. So I like to relate these early discussions with our work. Of course, the last thought experiment is the Schrodinger cat experiment, and you know all about this experiment with just trapping a cat in a box with a single atom, and if the atom is in superposition of two states, the cat should be in a superposition of two states, and this is exactly what we are doing with our photons interacting with atoms in the cavity. And as you know, and this is the topic of this meeting, and this is a topic that Wojciech Żurek has been studying for many, many years and giving a lot of enlightening discussions and details about that. This is the issue of the boundary between the quantum and the classical world. What I want to stress is that at the same time that they were discussing all these experiments, these people did not believe that the experiment would be one day possible. And I remind you here of two sentences that you certainly know made by Schrodinger. The first one is that we never experiment with single electrons, atoms, or small molecules. In thought experiments, we assume that we do, and it always results in ridiculous consequences. So the problem here is, what does he mean when he said ridiculous? This is important. And I think it's also interesting because in 1952, Schrodinger knew, of course, that single particle did exist. If you look at cloud bubble chambers or cloud chambers, you see the traces of single particles. But Schrodinger said, and I think he's right in saying that, that this is a kind of post-mortem physics, because you observe the traces left by particles after they have decayed. And he illustrated that by another sentence saying, it is fair to state that we are not experimenting with single particles any more than we can raise ichthyosauria in the zoo. We are scrutinizing records of events long after they have happened. So in fact, what he says is that particle physicists are like paleontologists, and we quantum information scientists, we are raising these strange state in the zoo, having them alive and playing with them alive. So Of course, all these experiments have become possible because of the development of physics and of quantum technologies. The most important one, and I think everybody would agree, has been the development of tunable lasers. They have given us the possibility to probe with an exquisite precision the energy levels of atoms, but also to manipulate the internal and external degrees of freedom of atoms. And all this started even before the lasers by the work of Alfred Kastler on optical pumping. He showed that light can be used to manipulate atoms. And this became, of course, practical when lasers were developed. The other ingredient is fast computers, classical computers, which allow us to store data and to look at correlations which occur at a very fast rate. And this is, it would be impossible to do all our quantum information experiments without computers, classical computers. And also you need, and especially in our experiment, the development of superconducting materials to make very highly reflecting mirrors. All these are quantum technologies, and which come from the knowledge that the founding fathers of quantum theory have introduced by their thought experiments. So I think it's very interesting, philosophically speaking or historically speaking, to see this kind of loop that you start by ideas which allow us to develop technologies, which allow us to come back to the ideas to test them. And I think this is very rewarding and very interesting in research in basic science. And it is one of the connections between basic science and application, which I find very interesting. So with all these technologies, of course, we have reached the particle control. And this was sentence which defined the last year Nobel Prize. I just want to stress that the experiments that Dave is doing in Boulder and the one we are doing in Paris are the two sides of the same coin. He's manipulating ions with atoms with photons, the atoms being trapped in his electromagnetic traps, and we do the opposite. We trap the photons and we manipulate them with atoms. And in both cases, we try to do in vivo physics as opposed to the postmortem physics I was mentioning before. And in both cases, we exploit light-matter interaction at the most fundamental level. The only equation that we use is the Jaynes-Cummings Hamiltonian in one form or the other. And again, there is here a historical reminiscence. This year is the 50th anniversary of the Jaynes-Cummings model, which describes the coupling of a two-level atom with a mode of the with an oscillator. In my case, the oscillator is a field, and in Dave Wynand's case, the oscillator is a mechanical vibration of the ion in the trap, and the coupling is made through the light matter interaction. So it's very, very symmetrical. And I also want to stress that many, many groups in the world are doing this kind of experiment. So we are just representing a big community of scientists which are controlling single particles and trying to make this useful for quantum information, for instance. So I will focus on our experiments, and I want to really to let you with the feeling that we are using Bohr's atom, the atom of the old theory of quanta, and having this atom crossing the Einstein photon box, making a clock out of this atom, and in this way being able to count photons without destroying the photons. And this will be a starting point to study Schrödinger's cat. So let's see how it works. Our box is made of two mirrors which are facing each other. These mirrors are machined out of copper with a very high geometric precision, nanometric precision of the surface, and we sputter a thin layer of niobium on these mirrors, so they are very highly reflecting. And we send single circular atoms through this cavity. This is the stage of cavity quantum electrodynamics. We study the interaction of light with matter in this box. A few figures about the mirrors. Light is bouncing more than a billion times on the mirrors, and the trajectory of a single photon is on the average 40,000 kilometers. That is, it takes 130 milliseconds for the photon to decay. And during that time, we can send thousands of atoms one by one and extract information from the field by these interactions. So this movie shows exactly how the experiment is going. You see the atoms will cross the cavity one by one, and after the atom have crossed the cavity, we destroy the atom, and we extract the information from the atom, but we don't destroy the field. So it's exactly the opposite of what Dave is doing. He's using lasers, and he's destroying the photons, but keep the atoms alive in his cavity. So you see this kind of movie, and then the atoms are destroyed, and you get a bit of information per destroyed atom. How do you get the information from the atom will be discussed. I don't understand, I'm not sure. That's, I have to make sure that I have all the slides I wanted. Yeah. This slide is not at the right place, I'm sorry. Yeah, what kind of atoms are we using for that experiment? We are using the Bohr circular atom. The way we prepare it is to start from a ground state, use lasers to promote an electron on a large orbit, and at the same time use radio frequency photons to feed angular momentum into the electronic orbit. And so in the end, we get a giant orbit, circular orbit, which is about 1,000 times bigger than the orbit of the ground state atom. This technique was developed by Dan Kleppner at MIT in 1983. And if you use the De Broglie picture, what we have is a De Broglie running wave going around with an integral number of De Broglie wavelengths, here 51 De Broglie wavelengths on the circle. Now, of course, in this orbit, which represents the Bohr atom, the electron is completely delocalized. The electron can be anywhere, so you have no electric dipole. If you want to build an electric dipole, what you can do is to make a superposition of two adjacent Rydberg states, one with 51 De Broglie wavelengths, the other with 50. And if you superpose these two states, by classical interference, you get a maximum of the De Broglie wave at one end and a minimum at the other end. So now you have a dipole. This dipole is a wave packet, and this wave packet is rotating at 50 gigahertz. So this wave packet is very interesting because now we are even before Bohr. We are at the state of the Jean Perrin atom. Perrin said that the atom is a planet around the sun. If you make a wave packet, this wave packet is a planet around the ion core. So this localized wave packet revolves around the nucleus like a planet around the sun. Or if you want to make another metaphor, like the hand of a clock on a dial, and this is an atomic clock, the Rydberg clock, which we'll be using in our experiments. So how you detect now the Rydberg states? You see here the two energy states in the Coulomb potential of the nucleus. One is more bound than the other. If you apply an electric field, you add to this potential the linear slope potential of the electric field, and you see that on one side, you lower the energy barrier, and you can lower it to the point where the upper state is escaping. So you ionize your atom, and the lower state is still bound. So you have a selective way of detecting the atom in one state and not in the other. And if you apply a ramp of electric field, you will reach the threshold for ionization at different times in the ramp for the two states. And now you get a binary signal, a bit of information per atom. So each atom, and if you want to use the language of quantum information, you have a bit of information per atom. When we started all this, it was in the 1980s, and we did not know anything about quantum information. In fact, we did not do that at all for quantum information purpose, but you see, you can translate all this in the language of quantum information. We have a classical bit of information given by each atom crossing our cavity. How do you use this to detect photons without destroying the photons? You have to have the atom interact with non-resonant light. So you tune the cavity slightly off resonance with atomic transition, and you use a light shift effect, which was discovered by Cohen Tanuji, who was my thesis advisor back in 1961. What Claude found out is that the energy of an atom interacting with a non-resonant mode of radiation is shifted with respect to its position without the field. And so you see that the two states E and G crossing the cavity will undergo a light shift in opposite direction, this light shift being proportional to the square of the coupling and to the number of photons, to the intensity of the light beam, and inversely proportional to the detuning. So if you decrease the detuning, you get a bigger effect. And you see that when the atom crosses the cavity, this energy difference accumulates a phase shift, and the atomic dipole undergoes a phase shift, which is just the integral of this energy shift, dz over v being just the dt, the time of that the atom cross the cavity. And you can define a phase shift per photon, which is huge. You can have a phase shift per photon which reaches a value pi. This means that after the atom has crossed the cavity, the atomic dipole points in one direction if there is zero photon in the cavity, and in the opposite direction if there is one photon, but the photon is still there. The photon has just been used to phase shift the atom. And so by measuring delta phi, you perform a non-demolition measurement of the photon number. So to do the experiment, you need an interferometer, of course, because you want to measure a phase. And so this is the experimental scheme. In the center, you have the cavity which contains the field you want to measure. On the left, you have the box which produces the circular states. They cross the system one by one, and they are detected downstream with this bit of information provided by each atom. Now, a very important ingredient are these two side cavities, which I called R1 and R2, and they provide classical pulses which prepare the atomic superposition before the atom enters into the cavity and analyze it afterwards. So the first cavity prepares, starts our stopwatch, this atomic clock, which accumulates a phase, and then the second flash of microwave downstream is used to analyze it. And in fact, this succession of classical pulses, which are applied one after the other, realize a Ramsey interferometer, which is the equivalent in time of the Young double slit interferometer in space. And this interferometer was invented by Norman Ramsey in 1949. Norman was the thesis advisor of Dave and also of Dan Kleppner, so you see that the story has a lot of connections. And this interferometer is being used in all atomic clocks. The big difference is that a good atomic clock maker tries to avoid perturbations, and we do the opposite. We try to get an atomic clock which is as sensitive to light perturbation as possible, and so we use Rydberg atoms. So you see the signal of an atomic clock is, of course, given by fringes. These fringes are obtained by measuring the probability to get the atom outside as a function of the frequency of the Ramsey zones. So you have beautiful fringes. In an atomic clock, what you do is that you lock your microwave source to the central fringe and it gives you the time standard. Here, what we realize is a clock which whose fringes are shifted by half a fringe interval when the photon number inside the cavity changed by one. And so if you tune your fringe, your interferometer at a fringe maximum, you see that the atoms will go out in one state if there is zero photon, in the other state if there is one photon. So we did the experiment in 2006, and you see here in real time what's going on. You see that for about 1 second here, the atoms were going out in one state, meaning that the cavity was empty, and then suddenly one photon pops in the cavity, stays for a while, and then disappears. And you see exactly the time at which the photon has appeared or disappeared. It's a quantum jump, which is observed here for the first time with light. You see also that hundreds of atoms see the same photon, which means that the method is non-destructive for the field. And I insist upon that fact because what motivated our experiments back at the end of the 1980s was a realization that all quantum optics was very poor quantum physics. If you look at the textbook in quantum physics, they tell you if you make an ideal measurement, the system should be in the end in the eigenstate of the measurement. And everybody in quantum optics were satisfied by the fact that when you looked at the photon was destroyed. In fact, they were all doing postmortem, the postmortem physics that Schrödinger was talking about. You look at the debris that the photon leaves on the photocathode after having disappeared. So we wanted really to do something different, and this is the first time this is done differently at the single photon level. I also want to emphasize that this is a, since we are interested in quantum information, this is a quantum gate. The photon in the zero and or one state controls the output of the other system, which is the atom in state E or G. This is a CNOT gate. And in fact, I think it's interesting because a lot of, in all kind of quantum information experiment, the Ramsey interferometer plays a key role because it's a very flexible device which is used to manipulate particles to perform all kind of gates. It is true in ion trap physics, of course, too. You can also, so this is how it works. You can also count larger photon numbers. For instance, you can inject in the cavity a small coherent field, a field which is produced by a pulse of classical microwave. So you fill up the cavity and then you switch off the source and this field is trapped, and then you will count the number of photons you have in the cavity. At the start of the experiment, you don't know how many photons you have, so you have a flat histogram, which is shown here. And then you send atoms one by one, and each atom will give you a bit of information. You have to be clever enough to decide what is the phase shape of photons that you have to adapt. And now we are doing that even in a more refined way. We change the phase shift per photon from atom to atom just to get the information faster. And you get this kind of signal. You see here how this histogram evolves into a single peak here. In this case, we have measured 5 photons. If you do the experiment again, in another realization, you will have 7 photons and so on. So this experiment illustrates all the postulates of a quantum measurement, and including the fact that once you have reached an eigenstate, you stay there. You keep measuring, you find the same value. So this experiment shows that you can really control the photon number, that you can prepare a Fock state. Of course, you don't prepare it on demand. In ion trap physics or in other experiments, you can prepare it on demand. Here, you prepare it statistically because you don't know which one you will get when you start the experiment. But once you have it, you can perform experiment with it. And of course, if you make a very large number of such experiments, you can build up a histogram. And in the case of a coherent state, you find the Poisson law. So you find that the field in the initial state is distributed according to a Poisson distribution. What I want to stress is this is a quantum experiment. One way of looking at it would be to say, OK, we have a box with some number of marbles in the box. We don't know how many we have, and we keep measuring. But this is wrong. In fact, at the beginning of the experiment, there is not a given photon number. You have a superposition, a quantum superposition of different photon numbers. And this is the experiment itself which produces the result and which decides the photon number in the end. So when you get this kind of statistical results here, you have no information about the quantum coherences between the Fock states, but there are quantum coherences. And these quantum coherences are, of course, essential for the Schrödinger-Cat experiment. So this was just a very long introduction before I talk about Schrödinger's cat and about the phase of these kind of fields. So as you know, light is at the same time a wave and a bunch of particles. And now, up to now, I have focused on the particle aspect of this by counting photons. Now I would like to stress the wave aspect. And so as Bohr said, this depends upon the kind of experiment that you are doing. So I will do now a different kind of experiment which will focus on the wave aspect of light. And this will bring us to the Schrödinger cat issue. First of all, for that, I need a very simple effect, which is a single atom index effect. I want to show that a single Rydberg atom interacting with our cavity field shifts the frequency of the cavity field and thus shifts the phase of the field by a large amount. And this effect is the other side of the coin I was describing before. If the field phase shifts the atomic dipole, reciprocally, the atomic dipole should shift the phase of the field. And in fact, it's very easy to understand how it works. You see here a standing wave in our cavity. The atom is crossing at an antinode, and the atom undergoes a light shift, which I have discussed before, which means that the potential energy of the atom in the field undergoes a dip when the atom goes across the cavity. This means that when the atom enters the cavity, its kinetic energy is increased. It is sucked in the cavity because of this energy shift, which is position dependent. And this increase of kinetic energy is given by this formula. It's proportional to the photon number and this constant here. But where does this energy come from? This energy can come only from the field. But it cannot come from absorption or emission of photons. It can come only from the fact that each photon has its frequency changed when the atom is inside the cavity. So it was omega when the cavity was empty. It becomes omega minus delta. And if you have n photons, the n photons have lost the energy nh bar delta. And if you equate this by energy conservation, you find that the field in the cavity undergoes a frequency shift, which is exactly the light shift per photon produced on the state E. It's just a matter of energy conservation. What does it mean? It means that, in fact, when the atom will cross the cavity, this energy shift will result in a phase accumulation of the field. The field in the cavity will undergo a phase shift, which is proportional to this quantity, and which is given by this expression here, which is just the same as the phase shift per photon produced on the atom. And this is a classical effect. If you put a piece of dielectric, transparent dielectric material in a cavity, you pull the frequency of the cavity. All classical engineers know that. The big difference here is that this is an effect at a single atom level. And there is a huge enhancement in order of magnitude. Think of a cavity in which you put a piece of glass. If you fill the cavity with a piece of glass, you will change the index of the cavity by a factor of from 1 to 1.5, or from 1 to 2, with the most refractive glass you can find. And you have something like 10 to the 23 atoms to do that. Here we have one atom, and you change the frequency by 1 in 10 to the 7, which is small, but which is 15 orders of magnitude larger than the effect per atom in the piece of glass. So you have, in fact, a huge enhancement of this single atom index effect because of the cavity QED properties. But the most important feature is that the sign of the effect depends on the atom state. If the atom is in one state, the phase shift will be positive. If the atom is in the other state, the phase shift will be negative. In fact, how do you observe that? I remind you first that a coherent state, which I have represented by this Poisson distribution, can also be represented in phase space by a vector. So you see here a classical wave, which can have three different phases. We know that a wave has an amplitude and a phase, and we know that all mechanical or electrical engineers represent these oscillators by a vector in the Fresnel plane. Here it's just three vectors at 120 degrees from each other. And quantum mechanically, you have the same picture in phase space. The only difference is the tip of your vector is fuzzy because of the quantum uncertainty. So the uncertainty on the length of the vector is just the fact that you have a fuzziness in the photon number. And the uncertainty in this direction is just the conjugated phase uncertainty of the field. And the bigger the field, the smaller the phase uncertainty, of course. And the distribution of this vector tip here is according to a Gaussian, and this is of course the Wigner function. So the Wigner function is a Gaussian, and which is centered at the point of the classical field amplitude and phase. So this is a classical field, and the question is can you measure that a single atom change this field? We did an experiment which is very simple in its principle. You start by injecting a coherent field in the cavity, so you see that you have a vector now in phase space, a Wigner function which is away from the center in phase space. Then what you do is that you send a single atom, and this atom will phase shift in one direction your cavity field, and then you have to measure that. Of course, you cannot just trust that you have done that if you don't measure that. That's the fate of us physicists. We're not like mathematicians. We really have to check that it has worked afterwards. So what we do, and the way we do that, is to use a homodyne method. But homodyne, don't read, it's a lot of text, but I will just explain in the pictures. We add a field which has the same amplitude as the field that we injected first, but which has a variable phase, and we scan the phase of the field that we have added. We change its phase continuously. And you see that for one phase, you will come back in vacuum. So how would you see that you have come back in vacuum? You send probe atoms across the cavity, but this time you send resonant atoms, which will absorb the field. And of course, if you are back in vacuum, they will have nothing to absorb. So you look at the probability that these probe atoms will stay in the initial state or not as a function of the phase of the field that you have homodyne with the initial field. And by doing that, you can reconstruct the distribution of the field in the cavity. You see here what happened when you have a coherent field with 30 photons. Without atoms, you have a phase distribution around the initial phase of the field. If you have sent an atom in state G, you see that the phase of the field has been moved on the left. And if you send an atom in level E, the phase of the field has been moved on the right. So you see that a single atom can really change the state of a field which contains many photons. And this is a simplified version of the homodyning method, which I will be describing later on, which we can, you can extend this method to reconstruct not only the phase distribution, but the whole Wigner function of any field in the cavity. What you do is that you just displace the field in phase space by adding another field and perform measurements on the displaced field. And I will come back to that. And in order to transform that into a Schrödinger cat preparation, we proposed back in 1991 the experiment which is described in this paper. This was done in collaboration with Luis Davidovich and Nissim Zaghiuri. We had this idea that a single atom going across a cavity would be able to build a Schrödinger cat. In fact, this is the very year where Wojciech published this famous paper in Physics Today about Schrödinger's cat, and I must say, and I will come back to that later, that this Physics Today paper, which was very, very important for us just to motivate our work. And we liked it first because it was written as a popular article, so it was very easy to read and to understand. And second, because it showed that we could use that to study decoherence. So in fact, at the end, as you see, at the end of this abstract, we said that the effects analyzed in this article could realistically be observed by using circular Rydberg atoms and very high Q microwave cavities, and that the possibility of photon manipulation through non-resonant field interactions opens a domain in cavity QD studies. So, but at that time, we wrote that because you always have to motivate what you do, but we could not have dreamed that this would have been possible to the extent that we did it, because we were lucky enough to be able to build this fantastically good cavity. And you need to have this kind of cavity to do this experiment. So what was the gist of this paper? We said that after a single atom has crossed the cavity, you can prepare a Schrödinger cat state whose Wigner function shows one part is a live cat, the other part is a dead cat, and the most important feature is that you have fringes in between, which describes the quantum coherence of the cat. And due to the fact that the cavity is not perfect, after a very short time, the fringes should be blurred and you should have a classical mixture of live and dead cat. So we described in this paper the way to prepare the cat and the way, and in a later paper we discussed in more detail the way to analyze the decoherence of the cat. So how do you prepare the cat? It's again, the miraculous apparatus is the Ramsey interferometer. It's a fantastic device that you can use for all kinds of purposes, as you will see here. We start by injecting a small coherent field in the cavity, and we send a single atom, and we prepare this atom in a superposition of E and G, and then we send it across the cavity. And because of the effect I have just discussed, the field will take one phase if the atom is in one state, and the opposite phase if the atom is in the other state. At this point, we have the Schrödinger cat situation. We have a single atom whose internal state commands a macroscopic parameter, which is a phase of a field containing many photons. But if you detect at this point, it's not clever, because if you find the atom in one state, you will come back with a coherent field with one phase. And if you detect the atom in the other state, you will find a coherent field with the other phase. By the way, this is also a measuring experiment. You can think of the field as a meter which points in different directions depending upon the energy of the atom. So it's a meter to measure the energy of the atom. But if you measure the energy of the atom, you will find one state or the other, which is a mundane classical result. If you want to get a Schrödinger cat, you need the second Ramsey zone. If the atom crosses the second Ramsey zone, the levels are mixed again. And if you detect now the atom, you have no way of knowing in which state was the atom when it crossed the cavity. So you keep the quantum ambiguity, and just one line of calculation shows that depending upon whether you find the atom in E or in G, you prepare the superposition of the two states with a plus or the minus sign. So detecting the atom in E or in G projects the field into a cat state superposition. There are many ways you can analyze this experiment, and one is very interesting because it connects us back to the complementarity experiment I was discussing before. You see what happens to an atom. An atom is going through the first and the second Ramsey zone, which means that it will follow two different passes in Hilbert space. If it stays in the initial state in the first Ramsey zone, it goes along this line. And then in the second Ramsey zone, it can go to the other state. So if you want to measure the probability to go from E to G, you have one pass, which is this one, and you have another pass, which is that one. In fact, it's like a Mach Zehnder. It's a Mach Zehnder interferometer, but in time instead of space. And you see the fringes, okay. But what does the field, if you have a coherent field in the cavity, the field in the cavity is a spy. It will point in one direction if the atom has crossed the interferometer in one state, in the other direction otherwise. And it means it will play the role of this moving slit in the Gedanken experiment. And you see that if the two final states of the field are disconnected, if they are orthogonal to each other, the fringes will disappear. So we did the experiment, and you see that indeed the contrast of the fringes depends on the overlap of the final state of the field in the cavity, which is a direct test of Bohr complementarity. So this experiment, in one way, the Schrödinger-Cat experiment is a test about complementarity. But of course, the next step is that we want to reconstruct the Schrödinger-Cat itself. So we want really not only to count photons, but also to have information about the phase. So I will say a few words about the homodyning method. If you perform a quantum non-demolition photon counting experiment, what you do is that you measure the probabilities for the photon numbers. That is, that in a Fock state basis, you measure the diagonal elements of the density operator, but you have absolutely no information on the off-diagonal, about the off-diagonal element. And the recipe to determine the off-diagonal elements is to do homodyning. You translate the field in phase space by homodyning it with current field of different complex amplitudes, and on many copies, you determine a function of the photon number in the translated fields. This is called tomography, and we have adapted it to our experiment. So let's see, you have a field that you want to know the density operator about. You start by injecting a homodyning field, so you send a coherent field on top of it. It amounts to a unitary transformation, which is given by this operator, which is a Glauber translation operator, which means that if you look at the diagonal element of the translated field, it appears as a linear combination of all the matrix elements of the initial field. And what you have access to is, of course, this. If you perform QND measurement, you measure the probability for the photon number in the translated field. And you see that if you are able to make many translations, and if you measure the red part here by doing statistical experiments, you get equations which give you linear, a set of equations which constrain all the non-diagonal elements that you want. So if you are able to invert these equations, you can reconstruct the density operator of the initial field. Of course, this requires many, many copies. I'm often asked, but what happens if you have only one copy? And as you all know, I am afraid that the only thing I can say is that there is no meaning to a wave function if you have only one copy. And I'm sure that Wojciech will agree, because this is behind that you have the no cloning theorem, you have all these things that we know about quantum information. So we tested the method reconstructing a coherent field. You see here, so you inject a coherent field, then you translate it, you perform these experiments, and you find beautiful density operator and a beautiful Wigner function by Fourier transform, which shows that we are really able to reconstruct our field. Then we do it for a Schrödinger cat, and you will see here on this representation how the experiment works. This is time, you have time on the horizontal axis and position on the vertical axis. So this red line represents the cavity, and these green lines represent the Ramsey zone. They are, of course, horizontal because hopefully they don't move during the experiment, but the atoms move, so the atoms will be given by lines with a slope. So at first we send atoms in the lower state because we want to absorb all remaining photons in the cavity. Don't forget that we are doing repetitive experiments, so after each run we have a garbage in the cavity and we have to reset the field to zero. So we send a lot of atoms that we call vacuum cleaners, because they clean back to vacuum. Then we inject a coherent field in the cavity. And then we send a single atom which will transform it into a Schrödinger cat. So at this point, after a single atom, we have a Schrödinger cat in the cavity. Then we translate the Schrödinger cat by a given amount. This is a homodyning. And after that, we send non-resonant atoms one by one through the interferometer. And these atoms are used to perform QND measurement of the displaced field. And so I spare you the details. You spend about 1 or 2 days working all the time with the students, and in the end, you get this kind of cat state. So this is an even cat, this is an odd cat. This cat, the photon number difference between the two sides is 7.5. In this one, you have 12 photon difference. You see the fringes here are phase opposite with the plus and the minus sign. So we get Schrödinger cats. So you see the Gaussian peaks and in between the fringes, which shows that you have a quantum coherence. And what you can do if you want to study decoherence is to prepare the cat to let it boil in the cavity for some time and to measure only after a delay. And doing that, of course, the theory is well known. We did it in our case in the paper I mentioned before. But this is exactly what Wojciech has done to study this situation. And you have, I make a little bit of publicity again for this paper. I don't think he needs any publicity, but I told about it already. And what this shows, that the decoherence rate increases with cat size. If you, the larger the cat, the faster the decay will occur. And you will see here a movie with snapshots of the Wigner function. You see here the time scale, 1.3 milliseconds. I remind to you that the time it will take for the two peaks to merge will be of the order of 1 to 200 milliseconds. But you will see that in a time 10 times shorter, the fringes will have been blurred. So you look at the fringes, so you see the loose contrast. You have fluctuations, you have some noise, but you see about after about 20 milliseconds, you can claim that you have a statistical mixture instead of a superposition. What will be the next step? Then I will go very fast. Once you have this cat, what you want to do is to preserve it, to keep it living in the cavity longer. In fact, we have some ideas to do that. In fact, when the Schrödinger cat loses a photon, it goes from even to odd. Of course, if the photon number is even at one point, the next point will be odd. So the loss of a photon is signaled by the fact that the sign of this peak of the Wigner function will change. And this you can see with a single atom. A single atom can measure the parity of the photon number. So basically, the way we plan to do the experiment is shown here. It's exactly the same experiment, but now as we detect the atoms, we send the signal to a computer, which decides whether the parity has changed or not. And if the parity has changed, it will command a change in the source of atoms and send an atom which will either emit or absorb a photon in the cavity. So I don't have time to enter into the details, but this is a movie which shows how it will work. An atom will measure the parity, then gives information to the controller, which will decide then to send an emitter atom, which will restore the photon number. So we are trying to do that. In fact, we have not done that for Schrödinger cat yet, but we have shown that the method works to preserve a Fock state, which is easier to do. And you see here what happens when you send sensor atoms, which decide what is the photon number in the cavity. And here you measure the distance towards the target state, which is here the Fock state with 4 photons. And these are the emitter and absorber atoms. And here you see how you can force the system to be driven into n equal 4 Fock state and stay forever there. And in terms of a time constant, it is the same kind of difficulties than for Schrödinger cat, because you know that a Fock state with n photon has a decay time t over n, where t is the cavity time, which is exactly the decay time of a Schrödinger cat. So this, at least on the time scale of this experiment, we should be able to do that for a Schrödinger cat. So I have reached the end of my talk. I just want to make one comment, to add one idea. Our experiments are very cumbersome. We have to work at very low temperature. We have big cryostats. Our qubits, our atoms, which I did not call a qubit so far, but they are qubits. They are flying qubits, which are destroyed in the end. And of course, even if you can demonstrate things about quantum information with that, you will never make anybody believe that you will have a quantum computer out of this experiment. Some people are working with solid-state devices which really emulate these systems very well, and this is the case of circuit QED. In circuit QED, you have Josephson circuits whose energy levels are quantized, and you can build very beautiful two-level system with this Josephson junctions. This is performed many, as you know, in many groups in the world. There is very, in the United States, you have the group at Yale and the group at USBC with John Martinis, and you have many other groups in the world. This is one kind of qubit here in this small stamp area here. And the cavity in their case is a coaxial line, which stores the standing wave of radio frequency. You see, so it's a coplanar resonator, which replaces the high Q cavity. You can drive the qubit through this microwave line. So this is the equivalent of the Ramsey field, Ramsey zone, plus applied to the system. You can drive the resonator directly. This is a way to inject coherent field in the system. And you detect by a squid. In fact, you destroy the state of the qubit by changing suddenly the flux across it. And this is very similar to our field ionization process. So this version of circuit QED can be translated very easily into the language of Rydberg atoms. There are a few differences. One difference is that this is 2 millimeters across, whereas our experiment is 20 centimeters across. A second difference is that they have to work at 20 millikelvin, and we work at 800 millikelvin because we are at a higher frequency. The third difference is that this is much bigger than the Rydberg atom, so the coupling to the radio frequency is much stronger, which means that everything is going much faster. So the processes which take microseconds in our case take nanoseconds in theirs, but at the same time, relaxation is also faster. So they can do the same kind of operation, but faster, which is an advantage for them. The advantage for us is that since we have a slow process, we can use quantum feedback, and I think the kind of experiments that I showed about the feedback technique is easier to implement in our case. But I just want to show you on the next slide how close the two experiments are. This is a Schrödinger cat from the John Martinis group, and this is our Schrödinger cat. So you already see that it's very similar. And I could give other examples. We have Fox states which look exactly the same and so on and so forth. And so I hope to have convinced you that we have come a long way since Bohr's atom and Einstein's photon box. On the left, you see the cover of Physics Today in 2007. At that time, we were very happy because we had gotten our first very good cavity working, and we were confident that we had a good advance over the circuit QED people, but this was wrong. In fact, you see that in 2011, you have another cover here, which shows that you can have many, at least here, 2 qubits, and now they've done it with more, and many cavities coupled to each other. And of course, this kind of design is, of course, much more easier to deal with because you can use lithographic techniques, well-defined techniques, if you want to go further. How far people will go, I don't know. Shuffling photons between real or artificial atoms may lead to application in quantum information. I just read that the John Martinis group has been able to factor 15, which is a feat which has been realized before in NMR physics, but it's good to have done it with their qubits. And they have done that with an error rate of 48%, which I think is not good for an elementary pupil in elementary school. But as you know, the difficulty is to find the factors. Even if you do it with a 1% success rate, it's good if you can do it for several hundred digits. Of course, we are very far from that. And I think this system might be, at first, very useful for quantum simulators rather than for quantum computers. So I will just conclude by acknowledging my coworkers, and I'm very much indebted, and in fact, I'm much more than that. In fact, all this work was done with Jean-Michel Raymond and Michel Boyne, who have been my students since the beginning, and I have been very happy to keep in my group over all this time. And many of the ideas and most of the experiments have been done by them, and so they should absolutely share the credit, as should the younger people. You see here Igor Dotsenko and Sébastien Glaise, who are fantastic young scientists who have been involved in the latest stages of the experiments I described. Sébastien Glaise won thesis was a non-destructive detection of single photon, and Igor Dotsenko has been involved in the Schrodinger cat and quantum feedback experiment. And all these people around are students and postdocs coming from all over the world. And I finish by this picture, which was taken in the same lab, in the same room, 46 years earlier, the day Alfred Kastler Nobel Prize was announced. So you see Kastler here. This is Claude Cohen-Tanucci, and this is me on the other side. And you see, I show it because Kastler is one of the guys who started all this story, because he had the idea that you could use light to manipulate atoms. And Kastler got the Nobel Prize in 66 for experiments which had been done by Jean Brossel. And in fact, nobody in our lab understands why Jean Brossel did not share the prize with Kastler. And you see how gentleman Brossel was. This was a day of certainly the big disappointment in his life. And you see how smiling he is. He never said a word about that. And this, the archives of the Nobel Prize Committee for 1966 will be opened in 2016, because it takes 50 years. And I really want to understand why he did not get the prize. It was not a matter of, because it was shared by no more than three people. Kastler got it alone. So it was not a competition between two groups. It just, I don't know why they skipped Brossel at that time. And the last picture will show you here something that to show that I want to share really with Jean-Michel Raymond and Michel Bouin, because I think you will never see us dressed like that anytime soon. Maybe one of them will get the same kind of dress at some point in the future. So thank you very much.
Initial Poisson distribution that changed over time as you observed it. Yeah. And I noticed that it had an increase in number for, I think, 5 photons, and then it went down and got a different number.
Yes, yes. As long as it has not converged, there is a randomness. And it's really like a horse race. If you look at it, of course, in slow motion, you have to take the computer back, and you see that some numbers. You have a feeling that some number will win, but the probability for the other number is not zero, and it can increase at a later time.
So that proves, doesn't that prove that you're not just finding out how many photons are there all the way from?
Yes, of course. It's just, so we really were fascinated. We had, in fact, you have to keep, you can't get addicted. You have thousands of these trajectories, and you want to look at each of them and to find out if there are some mysterious things. But the only mystery is that the randomness of the process.
More questions?
Yes. So
one just measure of curiosity. And you have these beautiful pictures where you do non-demolition measurements.
Yes.
And you know, after a while it saturates 7 or 8 But there is a moment of hesitation when there are several of them sort of rattling around.
Yes.
Should one attribute any physical significance?
Yes, I think it's just what I, the answer to Charles, it's the same thing. It just, you know, each time you get an atom, it multiplies the former distribution by a sine function, which is random. And so, of course, things are evolving. And the nice point that we had done all this by computer before, with working with Nissim Zaghouri and Jean-Michel Raymond, they had used computers, and all you see exactly the same trajectories. So you really have to know what experiment should be, not to have the temptation just to take the computer simulation and to not to do the experiment. But we did not learn anything more that was in the computers, except that you need a very good random number generator to simulate. If your random number generator is not good, and you average thousands of trajectories, you don't find the Poisson distribution that you should. And it tells that the really random number generator is quantum physics itself.
Any further questions? So let's think.
Okay.